This conference will now be recorded.
Suresh, let us wait for other people to join so then I can start the class.
Okay, sir. Yeah, actually, some network connection is not good.
Yeah, I think
so.
Chennai has completely a problem, right? Few areas and all.
Yeah.
Okay. Is it controlled or still it is the same problem, like floods and all?
No, no floods and all. It's
okay.
A little bit trailing.
Oh, okay. Okay. Anyway, the sessions are getting recorded. You can talk to the team and you can get all the recordings.
No, actually, yesterday and day of before, yesterday, two classes, I didn't get the record. So
okay.
I called yesterday, but no one didn't pick. For that one, I asked the request today. At least today.
Okay, do one
session.
Thing. Okay, drop an email or call once again today.
I sent email today morning. Visual Sayed and Divya. I looked
okay.
At the drop email. At least today, class session I record.
Okay.
If my
fine.
Network is okay, no issues. If my network is not good, so for that one, I request. I called today
okay.
Morning also, but no.
Okay, we'll see. Okay. I'm deleting all the pods which I've created yesterday. No need to worry again. We'll keep on recreating the pods, right? So it's not a big issue. So anyway, I have YAML files here. I'll share with you what we have done. Get dates. delete what's happening. We'll wait for 2 more minutes and we'll start the session.
Okay, sir.
So today I will give you one task. So try to do it. It is just a combination of init containers and normal containers. So which you need to do in a pod. Try it. If you are not able to do it or if you are stuck somewhere, I will provide you the YAML file. So you can refer and see whether you are thinking in the correct way or not. Okay. So I'll explain you the scenario. Just try to write a YAML file in order to create a pod where we need to have 2 containers. By the end of the session, I will tell you what need to be done. Diagrammatically, I will show you what need to be done. So try to write a YAML file. Maybe you'll face some issues, but anyways, at last you will be succeeded. At least you will try to understand how to write this particular YAML files, what syntaxes I need to follow and all. Okay. So my suggestion is start from today writing a simple YAML files. Start adding some particular things into it, which I told you. Okay. Then you will understand. So when you do from your end, then you will understand the scenario of writing this YAML files and understanding the Kubernetes concept. If I say theoretic, if I show practically from my end, everything seems to be okay. But when you do practically, then you will face a problem. So that is the best solution which I give to my previous classes or current classes which I'm doing. Don't rely on my experimental outputs which I show. Okay, let's get started. So today, what happened? This is a hamstring issue. Okay. So I'm deleting all the pods which I have created yesterday. And I'm just in order to get out of this confusion and all. So that's the reason I have deleted all the pods which belongs to my particular namespace, that is default namespace. Okay, so you can see now get pods. You can see there are no pods right now. So let me create one particular pod, which is like volume concept. Okay. So volume in the sense, yesterday we have seen, right? What is the purpose of volumes? Volume in the sense, shared volume with your pod. Okay. Wherever you're trying to launch a pod. Okay. So this particular pod will be, before that, your Kubernetes will create a volume, whichever type you have specified, whether it is MTDR, host path. There are different ways to create a volume in the backend, but as of now I am specifying only MTDIR. Okay, remember only this particular point as of now. So this volume will be shared among all the containers within this particular pod. Though we have one particular container here, this container is using this particular volume, okay, shared volume here. So let me show you the diagram once again, which I showed yesterday. I'll show you the diagram once again, and then we can go through it. So yesterday I have created a pod. Let's say this is my pod. Okay. Now we are creating a volume. Okay. So let's assume that this volume is nothing but empty air volume, which you are creating. So I'll draw in a cylindrical form so that you can understand. So I am trying to create a container here. Yesterday we have created two containers. Okay. So what is the purpose of the pod? The concept is simple: grouping multiple pods together logically and providing the shared volume and shared network is called as pod. Okay, wherever you go, tell the same definition when someone is asking about your pod. No one can argue with you saying that it is wrong. If they argue also, tell the same thing that pod is nothing but logically grouping multiple pods to multiple containers. Okay, and providing a same storage and shared volume and shared network is called as pod. Okay, so pod will assign with an IP. Okay, so common IP for both the containers. Internally they will communicate with the local host IP address, but externally you can communicate with the pod IP. That concept you know. So these pods are connected to this particular volume. Okay. So whatever the data is written by this particular container in a directory that which is mounted to this particular volume, so that data will be available for this volume also. Okay. So whatever the volume is present, whatever the data is present in this volume, this will be available to that particular mount path. Okay. So that is a general scenario. Now, what is the purpose of volume and what is the benefit of the volume? If your container is deleted here, let me ask you one scenario. Let us say that new image. Let me take new one. Okay. So I have taken a new image. Let's say you have a pod. Let us assume this is a pod, the white color one. Okay. So here you are trying to create a volume. It can be MTDIR, host path, whatever it is. We don't care about the volume type as of now, but it is a volume. Now you are trying to create a container. Okay, you are attaching this container, in the sense you are mounting container date directory to this particular volume. Now, unfortunately, I have, let us say this is my pod. Okay, I will tell that this is a pod. Okay, this is a volume of MTDIR. Okay, and this is your container. Okay, so this is your pod, okay, and this is your container, and this is your volume. Now let's say if you have deleted your container, then the volume will be deleted. Let us say due to some reasons you have deleted your pod, okay, and you are trying to recreate it or whatever it is. It is recreated with due to some reason, or there is, let us say it is restarted. What happens to the data which is present in the volume? Will it be wiped out, or you will have the data content present here? Can someone answer this? I hope you understood the scenario. Let's say I have created a container which is attached to this particular volume in the pod. If I, unfortunately, this particular container is restarted due to some reason, what happens to the data which is present in this particular volume container? Will it be like, it is recreated, or whatever it is, say it is recreated, this container. So what will happen? The data will be present, or it will have nothing? Can someone answer this? What happens to the data which is present in this container if it is restarted or recreated in the pod? Still it has the data or not? Yes, it has the data. Though you recreate the container, in the pod, okay, the data will be present. But if you delete the pod, your entire volume is deleted. That thing you need to remember. Okay. Yes, data will be there. Yeah, that is true. So Harish, that is correct. So data will be present if you recreate the container of the, or if the container is restarted. But if you delete the pod, your data, your volume is deleted. Entire the, whatever the concept is present in this particular pod is wiped out. Okay, you don't have a volume and you don't have a container. But if your container is recreated, the data will be present because it is reattaching the volume. So that's the reason the data will be present. So let's see one experiment of Redis, and I will show you practically how the volume is still present in that particular container. Okay, so let's do theoretical practical work right now and see how it works. Oh shit. Control Z. Redis volume, okay. .yaml. Now, here I hope you understand this particular type of resource you are trying to create. It is a pod. The name of the pod is Redis. The name of the container is Redis, and the image name is Redis. Volume, you are mounting this particular directory to the volume. So in practical, in theoretical, if I want to say, this is mounted with slash data slash Redis directory. This particular directory which is present in the container is mounted to this particular volume. Okay, I will mute it. No issues. Okay, I understood. Okay, you are unable to mute. Okay, you can typo, or if you have any concerns, you can drop an email. Okay. Yeah. So this particular directory is mounted to this particular volume. Okay. So these two are mounted. So whatever the data you write in MTDR, it will be visible in this directory, under this directory. Whatever the data you write in the, under this particular directory will be visible in the volume. Okay. So that theoretical part is clear, right? So that is what we are trying to do. So that's the reason here the name and this name should be matching. Then only it will use this particular volume. Okay. So let's try to create this. QTTL. Create or apply, whatever it is. It's under creation. Let's see. Let it be completed. And then I will show you. I will try to delete. I will try to restart the pod. Restart the container, and we'll see whether the data is present or not. Okay. First, we are trying to create a pod that is under process. Let's see the status. Yeah, so it's running right now. So let us log into the pod. Okay. Kubectl exec hyphen ti. Okay. Give the pod name. Since I have only one container, so no need to give hyphen c option. So then bash. So you logged into the pod. Okay. Container actually. The pod, container which is present in the pod. Okay. Let's go to the directory called Redis. Okay, this is the actual directory where it is mounted to your volume. So now let's create some files. Okay, let's say touch file. Let's say Sudams. Let's create some random files. So totally it will create five files here. I will write some content into the file. This is volume data. So you have these files. I have written the content. You can see the size of the file is 43 KB. Okay. Now let us check the process. I will show you how to do the experiment. So ps-aux command, just execute it. Oh, ps is not available. Let's install that particular package. Install ps. It's not ps actually. The package name is. We need to install the package apdf and get install proc ps. Okay, this proc ps, the package name. Okay, we need to do update first. Apdf and get update. Since it is a fresh container which is created, we need to do an update first and then we need to install the package. I think it's why we I got this split window. Oh shit, man. So now we have done update, you have written the data, everything is done right now. Okay, so let's check the ps-aux command. Not installed. So now this package is installed. So this is. If I kill the process, see, if I kill the process, the container will be restarted. Okay, you can see exit from this, get pod C, restart is zero. Restart in the sense your container is not yet restarted. Okay. Let's log into this and execute the ps-aux command. Let's try to kill the process. Okay, what is the process one? It's killed. Hyphen nine, that is, sorry. All. Process. You can see it is not there. Let's exit and see the pod. It should be restarted. Just a second. Just a second, guys. Give, yeah. So now it is exited. You can see git pods, it is in completed state. Okay, so we'll see what will happen. See, now it, you can see it is now running state because it is restarted. You can see restarts one. Okay, now let us log into the pod once again and we will see to the container once again and we'll see whether our data is still existing or not or whether it is removed. So let's see where it is. You can see the data is still existing. Okay, so this is the advantage of using volume. Okay, But the problem is, if you delete the pod, your volume will be deleted. Okay, so this is called as M-formal storage. The concept which you are trying to use now, it is called as M-formal storage. There are two types of storages, M-formal storage and persistent storage. As of now, the volumes which are creating is like M-formal storage as of now. We are using volumes and then we are specifying MTDR or host path and all, right? These are like these are called as like M-formal storage. Okay, in Linux machine, the M-formal storage is nothing but your RAM. How long the data will be available in RAM? Till you run your machine. Once your system is shut down or it is restarted, all the data which is present in the RAM will be wiped out. So that is called as M-formal storage. Okay, that, which is not permanent. Okay, so what is permanent persistent storage? Which is permanent. Until you delete, it doesn't delete. Okay, let's say hard disk. Hard disk data, you're writing some data. I'm creating some files in the hard disk. So that will be not deleted, right? If I restart my machine also. So that is advantage of using persistent storage. So it is up to you which one you want to use. If you want to use a volume, which it should be available only till the pod is available. Okay. So then you need to go for volumes. If you want the volume, even after deleting the pod, then you need to go for persistent volume. Okay. So you need to make a decision when you are deploying an application in Kubernetes. Okay, but my position is right now is to explain you both the differences. So I've explained you what is the difference, what is a volume as of now. If you delete a pod, okay, and if you recreate it, you cannot see the data. So let us see the second experiment. Okay, so we have seen how to, let me exit from here. Actually, I need to close this terminal. Just a second, guys. Kubectl get pods. Okay, now what I will do, I will try to delete this particular pod and delete this Redis. Now after this, I will try to recreate it. Kubectl apply hyphen -f Redis pod. Now your pod is getting created. Let's wait for the creation and we will log into the pod and we will see whether the data is present or not, which we have created earlier. Okay, if that is present, that is called as permanent storage. But we know that it is an M-formal storage, the data should not be available. Okay, so this is the second scenario which I'm showing you. Okay, in this experiment, I will show you the first experiment, first scenario, which is like if you recreate, if you restart your container, the data is still existing because your volume is not deleted. So let's see whether it a container is created. Yeah. So let's log into that. Let us see the data which is present in Redis. The data is not available because previously we have deleted a pod, in the sense your volume is also deleted. Okay. So here we have deleted this particular pod. If your pod is deleted, your volume is also deleted, obviously. Okay. When you delete your pod, your volume is also deleted. So if you recreate a pod, your volume is a fresh volume, it is not an existing one. Okay, so it will create as a new volume. So that is called as M-formal storage in Kubernetes. Okay, so I hope you understood, or do I need to repeat any second time, or it is not required? Is it clear, Suresh and all? Because these concepts are important, because when you work in real time, you need to understand which volume type you need to use for which kind of, see, it doesn't mean that for everything you will use the same type of volumes. you need to think of the application, its requirements, and then you need to create a resource according to that. So that's the reason I'm giving you a practical example of it. Okay. Because I cannot get all the application deployed here, right? It will take longer time. It will be 2 to 3 months, of course. So I'm taking some few examples of applications, and I'm trying to show you what it will do exactly, and what are the limitations we have in this particular object which we are trying to create, whether it is volume, whether it is pod, whether it is deployment, whatever it is. Okay, so this experiment is clear for everyone. So let's go further and see the next experiment. So the next concept, here comes the next concept. So if you want to get the details of init containers, I've shown you this. This not mandatory. So I've given the example of informal storage here. So this is one of the informal storage. See, and then you can also specify the resource request like informal storage. You can specify this. This is nothing but the storage which will be used by your local machine. Okay, that's all about it. Okay, so let us try to create this one, for example. Try to create this. We can say like I hope you know what is env. This is nothing but environment variable, which I already shown the experiment of this same experiment I have shown you. But here the concept is, previously we have specified CPU and memory, right? Now this part is nothing but storage, hard disk. It's not CPU or memory. Memory in the sense it is RAM. CPU in the sense it is CPU utilization, core CPU, like your core processor. Okay, informal storage in the sense it is a storage which you are trying to request for. Okay. So let's create this kubectl create -f informal. So let's give all. So out of two containers, zero is ready in the sense it is under creation process. Guys, tomorrow morning there might not be a class. I'm not sure. I will update by today night itself. Okay, by 10 o'clock or somewhere, whether tomorrow morning we have a class or not. But for sure, day after tomorrow we'll have a class. If tomorrow is we don't have any class, day after tomorrow we have a class. If tomorrow we have a class, day after tomorrow we don't have any class. Again, Sunday we can have a class. Sunday for sure, I will take a class. In morning time, right? It's not a big issue for me because I'm traveling to my home. I'm not yet decided whether to travel tomorrow morning or day after tomorrow morning. So that's the reason. Okay. Anyway, I'll be in touch in WhatsApp. So no need to worry. It's under creation because both the images are new, which is getting downloaded. Still under creation. Let us wait, because might be the image size might be large or network is a bit slow in order to download the image. There will be multiple reasons. You can see both are running right now. Okay, so if you look at the YAML file of this, emergency नहीं हम उस पर. तो वी हैव रिक्वेस्टेड द इनफॉर्मल स्टोरेज ऑफ 4 GB एंड द रिसोर्स रिक्वेस्ट इज 2 GB एंड इट माइट इंक्रीज अप टू 4 GB बेस्ड ऑन द रिक्वायरमेंट. ओके फॉर दिस कंटेनर वी हैव रिक्वेस्टेड फॉर 2 GB एंड इफ इट इज रिक्वायर्ड इट विल गो अप टू मैक्स ऑफ 4 GB. ओके इफ इट इज क्रॉसिंग मोर देन दैट योर पॉड विल फेल और समथिंग इट विल गो टू द बैक ऑफ लाइक आउट ऑफ मेमोरी स्टेट. ओके सो दैट इज द वन थिंग वी नीड टू रिमेंबर एंड दीज आर द इवेंट लॉग्स व्हिच वी हैव. Okay, if you want to pull only event logs, then what we need to do, grep hyphen capital A. Okay, let's say like 10 or whatever it is, we need to pull for events. You can see, I'm pulling only event logs. Okay, you can give this. These are like regular expressions which we give. Using grep command, we can filter the previous command's output. That is filtering concept. Out of You will use normal filtering in websites, right? Same filtering. In Linux, we have grep command. Okay, hyphen A in the sense after this particular search, I need to print 10 lines. After events, I'm searching for a word called events. Okay, after that, I need to print 10 lines. Okay, so that's the reason this data has been printed. This data. Okay, that is a simple thing. And so there is one more concept in a pod that is called as liveliness and readiness pods. This concept I will tell you after the entire concepts are clear, because this is a bit tricky. So you need to understand the concept. So it is not needed right now. So after a few days, I will try to explain what is this liveliness and readiness pod, when to use it. Okay, for sure I will explain it, but not now. Okay, because it needs some theoretical concept which I need to explain, which will take a longer time. Before that, we'll go for the other concepts. It is not a dependent technical, what do we say, resource that you need to understand as of now. Okay. So let's go to the next concept called replication controller. So let's discuss theoretically what is this, what exactly the requirement of this replication controller, what are the advantages we have. Okay. So let me take a new window. Transparent value. Transparent is. Okay. Now let's say you are trying to create a pod as of now. Okay. Let's say I have a pod. Here there is a pod. Okay. And here, let's say this is the pod. It might be launched on minion node 1 or minion node 2, whatever it is. We are doesn't bother about the node where it is launched. But this is the pod. Okay, you are accessing the web application here. Everything is well and good. Now, let's say if this particular pod is down, what will you do? Okay. So we don't have any other pod which is having the same application, right? So we don't have any other pod which has the same data or same application details. So then you are going into an application downtime. So we don't want to fall into that particular situation. So we want an spare pod where the request can be sent to this particular pod. If this pod is down, immediately it will transfer the information to this particular, it will get the request from this particular pod. This is called as replication. And this, there is one more advantage, is like if the load is getting increased on this particular node, automatically it will create one more pod with the same features. Okay, that is called as auto scaling. Okay, in pod in replication controller, we have auto scaling as well as we can scale it manually. Okay, we can scale it manually or we can set an auto scaling group. Okay, in the replication controller. So replication controller in the sense, it will create a same pod of replica. In the sense, it is like cloning, and it will ensure that both are running in a desired state. So what Kubernetes will do, when you say replica, we need to create of 3, it will create 3 pods with a similar architecture, similar details. And if any one of the pod is down, immediately it will try to create a third pod. It will ensure that there are 3 pods running in the background. If any one of the pod is deleted, automatically it will try to create a new one. So it will ensure that all the three are running up and running. That is the advantage of using this replication controller. Okay. So let's see how to create this replication controller. We will do an experiment, like we'll try to delete one particular pod and we'll see whether it is automatically getting created or not. Okay, so let's see the YAML file, what we need to write in order to create a replication controller. Okay, so this is what theoretically they have written. There are too many ports. The replication controller terminates the extra ports. If there are too few in the sense, if there are less ports than the desired one, then it will try to create a new port in order to match the replica. If it is more, it will delete the extra ports. If it is less, it will try to match the desired number of ports that need to be running. Okay, so that is advantage of using replication controller. Okay, the short term is RC. In Kubernetes, we'll give like this: kubectl get RC. As of now, we don't have any replication controller. Okay, so if you want to see in all namespaces, -- all namespaces, we don't have any replication controller in the entire Kubernetes setup. Okay, so let's try to create it. So here is a sample example we have for Nginx. See, to list all the pods belongs to the replication controller in the machine, reachable from. Okay, we need to execute this command. So before that, let's try to create a replication controller of Nginx. You can see here. So the API version is same, V1. Whatever you are used for pod, it is the same API version we are using. Okay, what is kind now? It is not pod, it is replication controller. R is capital and C is capital. Okay, and what is the metadata is nothing but the name of the replication controller. Okay, spec in the sense, how many we are trying to run? 3 pods. So this replication controller will ensure that there are 3 pods of Nginx running in the background. How will you identify? Using selector. So all the 3 pods will have the same selector, in the sense same labels. Okay, template, metadata, its name of the every pod which we have. So it will give the pod name as Nginx, container name as Nginx, and then we'll have a pod name now called Nginx and all. Okay, and this is the name of your template, and this is the label of that particular template. So all the, for whichever template you give the particular same label, it will create with the same container. Spec in the sense, your container details. Okay, so let's save this. So here the template details are important. Template in the sense, this template details are important because all the 3 pods should follow the same template. How it will identify? Using selector. Okay, using selector, it will identify. This is the selector which we need to use. Okay, this is the key and this is the value. All the 3 pods which is having the same selector will have this particular template assigned. Okay, so let's save this file, come out of this. So kubectl, either you can use with create or apply, both the things, -f rc-nginx. Okay, so it is under creation, you can see get replicas. So the desired number, it should have 3. Currently they are running with 3. How many are ready? 0. So it is under creation process. How will you see that? Kubectl get pods. You can see here. These are the 3 pods which need to be run. If you want to see where these pods are created, you can see with void. You can see one, it is running on kubeminion 2. One is running on kubeminion 1. Again, the third one is running on kubeminion 2. Okay, so that is how it is segregated. So now the 3 are running. So we need to see RC value saying that 3 are ready. Currently there are 3 are running successfully. Desired state is 3. Okay, so what we will try to do an experiment saying that if you want to see the description of this particular replication controller, we need to give -in YAML format. If you want to see -u YAML YAML format, if you want to see the description of it, then say like is it Linux? Okay, You can see the description. So these are the event logs. You can see replication controller created pod this one, created pod this one, and created pod this one. Successfully created. Okay. So these are like three should be running. Three are running, zero waiting, zero succeeded. In the sense, everything is completed, right? Zero or failed. Okay, nothing has been failed. So this pod template in the label is so important. App is equal to Nginx. So that is what we have specified, right, in the template. Okay. So now let us do the experiment as of now. So I need to show you whether it is really, really it will recreate the pod or not. Okay. So let's delete one pod. I will try to delete this particular pod. Delete pod. You can see the pod, it is getting created. You can see immediately it is getting created. You can see now only two are ready. Okay, so now two are ready. It's, you can see the container is getting created. Have you seen this 6D FPD? No, right? This is the controller, replication controller name, and followed by your pod ID. It is okay. So you can see here there is no 6D FPD, right? So this got deleted and this has got created. So it will ensure that all the three are running successfully. So now let's see the desired state. So three are completed. I hope you can see that. See, it is created 45 seconds ago. So this is the latest one. So this is the advantage of using replication controller. I hope you understood. See, underlying it is using a pod concept, but on top of it, you are logically creating as a replication controller. Logical, that is a logical. Okay, so underlying pod is a common thing which we use. Okay, how we use a Docker as a common thing for Kubernetes or Docker Swarm, it is right. Same thing, pod is a common layer for all your replication controller, replication set, deployment, whether you create auto scaling, okay, daemon set, whatever you create, it is the base is pod. That's it. So that's the reason we started with the pod creation. Okay. So this is how we need to verify whether you have it is created properly or not. So it is executing and it is creating properly. Okay. So we have created a replication controller properly. Everything is running fine. Your Kubernetes is properly creating when there is not running with the desired number of pods. So automatically it is creating it. When I deleted a pod, automatically it is trying to create a new pod with the same template. Okay. Anything that I need to repeat, or this is clear? I hope you understood this, or if not, I will try to repeat it. Okay, so if you want to pull all the pods, matching with this particular label, you can see there are three pods, Nginx-27D7D, and there is Nginx-6DFPD, and then Nginx-GMSHP. So these are the three pods which we have. You can see here also, 27D7D, 6DFPD, and GMSPH. Okay, so these are the shortcut command in order to pull the using selectors. Obviously, if you want to see the labels of the pod, you will give show hyphen labels. You can see the label. This is the same. This is the common label for all these three pods. Okay. So that is the concept of your replication controller, which we are using right now. Okay. So let's go to the replication set. So there is a slight difference between replication set and replication controller. Replication set uses the same concept, but replication controller doesn't have any rolling updates or automatic rolling. You can see this. Okay, I'll show you the experiment of it. Where is it? Okay. So the basic difference between the replication controller and replication set is nothing but this is nothing but replication. You see, you can hear the major difference between is that rolling updates command works with replication controllers, rolling updates, okay, but won't work with replication set. So because a replication set comes by default with deployment functionality, deployment is one of the Kubernetes objects we have, we'll create after this replication set. So deployment is nothing but in backend, it will use replication set as a backend functionality. Under replication set, again, it will use pod as a functionality. So it's like layer. Okay, so that's the reason replication set doesn't have any rolling updates. So obviously, replication controller has a rolling updates. Okay, so that is a major things which we have and you can take care of. So let's see, like kubectl scale. Let's try to increase the replicas on a fly. Okay, let's try to do that. You can give this particular okay. kubectl scale. We'll give like this. Information. Replicas equal to, let's say, 5. Okay. And the name is, the file name is RC. This one. Okay. You can see now it is scaled. So let us see whether it is scaled or not. You can see it is creating additional. So already we have 3, only 2 are pending, right? Out of 5, 3 are already created. 2 need to be created additionally. So that's the reason it is creating 2 of them additionally. Okay. So from the file itself, you are trying to create it. So it is taking the template of this particular file. According to this particular template, it will create additional 2 replicas. Okay. So then you can see the count of the replicas using replica count. You can see that now it is running. It's saying that it is running. So successfully, you can see that 5 pods are running as of now. If you want, you can decrease it. I'll run with 2. So now it will reduce it to 2. You can see it is terminating the additional pods which we have. So it will ensure that only 2 pods are running. If it is running more than 2, it will try to delete it automatically. Let's see whether it is submitted. Yeah, so now you can see all the additional pods have been deleted and you can see the replication count right now it is set to 2. Okay, so that is all about your replication controller. Okay, so I think we are running out of time, so let's see replication set as of now and we'll wind up. So tomorrow we can see the deployment. Okay, what is it? So replication set, I told you, right? It is the same thing. Additionally, we are creating with some concept like match labels. Okay, so we are giving that. So additional things we are looking at, like app label must be socket. So we are creating like this. So let's see this example. Same YAML file. It will be like same. You don't feel any difference by looking at this. Replication set hyphen genius or something. Try to create this. Mapping values are not allowed for this context. Line one. Okay. Got it. There is a problem with the lines. There is additional space. Since it is getting created, let's see. Will you see with this? No. Replication set it is. Okay. This RS. So it is ensuring that there are three replications. Replication controller is represented with RC. Replication set is represented using RS. And the pods are same. Kubectl get pods. You can see here, it is trying to create three. Let's see what is running. It is under creation process. So that's the reason the ready, it's not showing any count. I would have given Nginx. If I would have given Nginx, it would have computed faster. Let it be deleted. What I will try to do, replication controller. I will try to replace this name, so it doesn't matter. The image, we'll try to use a common image which we use. Nginx is already present, right? So that's the reason it will take less time to create. And the pending in the sense it is almost created. Okay.
తూర్పుగోదావరి జిల్లాలోనే ఆవిడ పేరు మీద ఆక్విడెక్ట్ కట్టారు డొక్క సీతమ్మ గారని మహాతల్లి
One is pending. If that is created, we are done with the replication set also. Yeah. So now you can see all the three pods are running successfully. So it's just a similar concept. So obviously, no need to directly create replication set. Obviously, we are using a deployment. So no need to read much about replication set. If you want to create only replication set, then we need to go for this particular concept. Okay. If you want to do with the deployment, then it is not required to create a replication set. Automatically, it will create deployment itself. So what is the functionality of deployment? Why we are not using a replication set? Tomorrow, we can see it. Okay. I will tell you the difference. What is the difference between replication and deployment? Okay. So that is mostly used in real-time experience. In real-time, most of the people will use these concepts. Okay. I hope you all understood this. Anyway. Using it. Okay, so tomorrow we'll meet at the same time. So I will tell you, I will update today by 10 o'clock whether we have tomorrow's class or not. Morning, if you don't have tomorrow, day after tomorrow, we'll have a class. Okay, so yeah, now.